Well, praise the Lord. Good evening, everybody. Today we're here together, and we're, you know, as I thought about it, and I said, what's the right word, you know? And I think I even said that last year, what's the right word? But, you know, we want to honor today. We want to, I want to use the word, I know celebrate is more towards Easter, but, you know, as we think about Good Friday, this is where it began. The redemptive work on the cross began. And today we want to reflect upon the cross and what that means for each and every one of us. What a gift from our loving Savior that he would lay down his life. I am humbled today that God loved me so much that he would take my place upon that cross. So this evening, as we begin this service, I just want to challenge our hearts just to remember what Christ did for us. The price he paid, it wasn't a cheap price. He gave us everything. He was all in for us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for today, God. Lord, we honor you. God, we thank you. Father, we are humbled by you, God. Lord, the love that you had for us, God. Father, that you were thinking about us while you were on that cross, God. Lord, you took my place. You took our place, God. Father, you paid the ultimate price for love. Love for your creation from a loving Heavenly Father. Tonight, God, we ask that you would just fill this place with your presence, Lord. Draw our hearts close to you, God. Father, as we give you praise today, as we give you glory, God, as we give you honor, Lord, Father, because you love us, God. Lord, have your will and your way today in our hearts, Father. We give you this time. We give you this moment. Father, we love you. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
I'd just like to invite you guys into a moment to reflect on the cross. And there may be some songs that you don't know the words to, but it's a time to feel the weight of the cross, but also the redemptive power that it holds.
Of glory died. See the story of Jesus going to the cross, and everything seems to kind of be hand in hand. And then there's this one character that seems to interrupt the narrative. His name's Barabbas. We don't even know much about him except that he's a murderer, a leader of an insurrection, a rebel. And why he's even mentioned, sometimes I'm not so sure. It's like, what? This is about Jesus going to the cross. So in this moment, Pilate thinks, I hold the destinies of these two men in my hand. I know the Jews have a tradition that on a holy day, I will release one of the prisoners on death row. Pilate stands on this audacious stage, who now presents Jesus, Son of the Living God, versus Barabbas, the thug and rebel. He says, all right, who do you want? This is blasphemy. This has gone too far. There's no comparison. This is a rightful prisoner, a man who should be on death row. He's a rebel against Rome. He leads a rebellion. He murders people. He's a bad man. He's a thug and he's a crook. He deserves the chains and he deserves the crucifixion. Jesus, what has he done but heal restore, deliver, set free, open blind eyes, open deaf ears, heal the lame and the leper. What has Jesus done? Who do you want? We want Barabbas. Yeah. Give us Barabbas. People say, give us Barabbas. The Roman soldiers come up and they put the key in and they unlock Barabbas from his chains and shackles. And he walks down the platform, welcomed by all of his thug friends. Yeah, the people love me. Yeah, that's right. I don't even know who this Jesus guy is, but all I know is my people love me. There seems to be no conscience in Barabbas. There's no record of him turning to Jesus and saying, I owe you everything now, for you have set me free. No, I don't see any of that in Barabbas. And God knew that. Jesus stood there, silent, for he knew the will of the Father. He said, it's fine, Father. Let him have Barabbas. For Jesus knew that the Father would have to treat Jesus like Barabbas so he could treat Barabbas like Jesus. Barabbas thought it was the people that set him free. No, 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 no. It was the love of a heavenly Father.
Watch and pray. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. And sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow.
Amen. Thank you, brother. Amen. Tonight I want to share just a few thoughts with you regarding the cross. Today we celebrate the cross. And I know how people would say, how can we celebrate the cross? Well, friends, because it was the beginning of Christ. His plan of redemption for mankind. Without Jesus, without his love for us, without his willingness to sacrifice, we would not be in relationship with our Heavenly Father. I am humbled when I think about God's love for me. When I think about his kindness, his mercy, his grace. Who am I that he should be mindful of me? I am a sinner saved by grace, by his loving grace and mercy poured out. You see, Jesus had a plan when he died upon the cross. There was a plan of redemption for mankind. You look at the beginning, at the fall of man, when man willfully chose to be disobedient to God, God immediately put in a plan of redemption. Genesis 3:15 tells us, and I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. Friends, the enemy thought he had a plan, but God's plan was much greater. God's plan that he would be in relationship with us. The Creator God would have relationship with his creation. Even at the point where we messed it up, I'm so grateful to God for his mercy and his grace. I mess it up on a daily basis. But you know what? God reaches down and says, hey, son, I had a plan. And guess what? That plan is still in motion today. Because the sacrifice of Jesus upon the cross forgives sins. I stand before you a sinner forgiven by God's grace, God's mercy, and God's plan. There was once a wise man. Well, he thought he was wise. He was an intelligent man, a learned man. And he came up to a pastor after service. And he says, I don't see the reason why we talk about the blood of Jesus. I don't understand why we have to talk about the shed blood for me. The minister responded, very well, then how do you propose to be saved? And the man answered, by following the example of Jesus. He says, that's enough for any man. The minister replied to him, okay, why don't we start that right now? And he says, okay. He asked him, how do you suppose to do that? He answered, I'm going to follow the example of Christ. The pastor said, if we're starting right now, let's be honest. Have you ever committed sin? the man kind of took a step back and said, well, sometimes. I don't know about me, but sometimes. Then he said, if you have sinned, then you cannot follow the example of Christ, because Christ was a sinless man. He said, what do I do? And he said, then, my friend, it appears you do not just need to follow the example of Christ, but you need a Savior that shed his blood for you. The second part of God's plan was his purpose. God had a purpose. He sent his son, Jesus, to die upon a cross, to shed his blood. Jesus was named by, Jesus was told that, Mary and Joseph was told that his name would be Jesus, because he would save their people from their sins. He truly is our Savior today. He's our Redeemer. He's our Rescuer. He had a purpose when he was on that cross. He thought of you and he thought of me. He said, someday my son is going to need a Redeemer. He's going to need a Savior. He's going to need his sins forgiven so that he can be in relationship with me, so that I can have relationship with my creation. You know, friends, there is no sin too big for the blood of Jesus. Sometimes we think, oh, Pastor, you don't know what I've done. You don't know what I come from. You don't know my past. I have to agree with you. I don't know. But I do know a Savior that shed his blood on the cross of Calvary for the forgiveness of sin. There is no sin that is bigger than the blood of Jesus. You may be in here tonight carrying a heavy burden, carrying the weight of sin. I want to tell you tonight, friends, there was a purpose for Jesus on that cross. It was to set you free so that you could walk in his love, in his grace, in his mercy, pardon from sin. It wasn't a cheap price. The purpose of Christ on the cross cost him his blood, cost him his life. Let me tell you something, friends. No one took Jesus' life. Jesus laid it down for you and for me because he loved us. Love for us put him on the cross. The Bible says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Jesus had a purpose. He was paying the price that needed to be paid. Today, as we remember that, as we honor that, let us remember the purpose for which he gave his life. It was that mankind could be reconciled to Creator, loving Father God. Lastly, there's a promise that comes with the cross. Jesus Christ, his sacrifice on the cross was one time for all eternity. One time for past, present, and future. Now, does that give us a license to sin? No, because we know the cost that it took to pay. But what it does tell us is that we have been forgiven of our past. We are in relationship and right standing with God if we've accepted that. And we know that going forward, he will be with us and help us and walk with us through life. There's a promise that he says he'll never leave us or forsake us. And he proved it by being upon the cross. We live in a society that is so much, I don't believe it. I have to see it. Where's the evidence? Where's the proof? My goodness, when you sign a contract, you got to sign initial, sign here, get it notarized. I mean, all these things to sign a contract. And then they still give you 3 days to get out of the contract. Jesus put up his very best right up front and said, here it is. He spread his arms open wide and said, I love you. We can trust that love. We can believe in that love because God put his very best right up front. What more proof or evidence do we need? The promise is that he loves us. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and be only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The promise is that we live forever with our creator back in relationship with God. What a promise. Never to be alone. Never, what a promise to have hope and a future with God. What a promise that we become the family of God. I love this verse and it speaks to my heart because it reminds me of the relationship I have with God. It says, yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. What a promise. What a promise of family. What a promise of love. Friends, we can walk out of here today knowing that God had a plan on the cross. Knowing that God had purpose in what he was doing. And knowing that there's a promise for us that not only can we live in right a relationship with our God now, but that we could spend an eternity with him because of his work on the cross. I want to pray with you guys. I'm going to invite the choir to come up. Friends, today, I don't know where you are in that relationship with God. I don't know what drew you here tonight. I don't know if there's something drawing you now. Maybe the Holy Spirit is working in your heart and saying, you know what, Pastor Roy, I needed to hear that God had a plan. That this thing just wasn't some made up story. Friends, I'm telling you it's real. How do I know? Because I've experienced God's love. I experienced God's promise in my life. And let me tell you what he's done for me, he can do for you. I want to pray with you tonight, and maybe in your heart, the Holy Spirit's kind of tugging on you. Maybe you've served the Lord and you've known him, but maybe you're far from him tonight. Well, guess what? God hears the prayers of his people. He's attentive to a prayer of reconciliation unto him. Maybe tonight you're here and you've never accepted the Lord. You heard the stories about the cross, but you've never experienced the power of the cross for you. And friends, that could be here for you tonight. You could walk out of here in right relationship with a loving God. I want to pray with you tonight. And I'm not going to do anything embarrassing or call you out or stand out. But what I am going to do is ask that in your heart, if those things are with you today, that in your heart and in your own being, you would say, you know what, Pastor Roy? I need to get right with God. We're going to make a commitment to do that. I'm going to ask everyone to bow your heads and close your eyes. See, friends, because the cross is so powerful, I don't want to have anybody walk out of here today without understanding the love of their Heavenly Father. If there's any today that say, Pastor Roy, you know what? I don't know this Jesus, but I need to know him. I want to know him. Would you slip up a hand? I just want to pray with you. All right. Amen. Amen. See those hands. Is there anybody that would say here today, you know what, Pastor Roy, I know you're speaking to my heart. And I know that I'm not in right relationship with my Heavenly Father. And I want to be assured of that today. Would you lift up your hands and just let me pray with you? Anybody say, that's me, Pastor Roy. Amen. See that hand. See that hand. Amen. See that hand. Amen. See those hands. All right. Amen. Anybody else before we go to prayer? Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love. Father, so freely you gave, God, that which cost you everything for us because you loved us, God. Today, Father, you've seen the hands that were raised that said they don't know you. Father, even right now, as they make that commitment in their heart, Lord, to say, God, I love you. Please forgive me. Come into my heart. Help me to live for you. Be my Lord and Savior. Father, those simple things, God, believing in who you are and confessing in their heart and their mouth, God, knowing, God, that you are able to transform and change their lives, God. Bless them now, I pray. Father, for those today, God, that have raised their hand, God, and know that they are far from you. Father, you paid the price for our sin. And because you did that, sin no longer has power. When we confess our sins, your word says that you are just, you are faithful to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, God. So, Father, with a humble heart, Lord, we confess sin before you even now, God. Father, with every hand that was raised, you know their hearts, God. Father, draw them to you, God, to that moment and point at that cross, Lord. And, Lord, we give these to you, God. Father, thank you for your love, for your grace and your mercy, for your forgiveness today, God. We know we walk out humble, healed, restored, and in relationship with a loving God. Father, bless each person here today, God. Father, let us not leave this place, God, without realizing your plan, your purpose, and your promise. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Jesus. I'm going to ask if Pastor Conrad, sorry. Hey, brother, we're speaking that in, man. That's how I was. To join us up here. Thank you, brother. Friends, what a privilege. Just to reverence the love of God, to experience it together as a family together. Tonight, we're going to partake in communion. Last year, I called it an offering. Praise God, we fixed that. So, I told Pastor to be proud of me. I was a young pastor in training, and I already tried to take an offering. But tonight, we're going to participate in communion together. Friends, what a great way. The Lord tells us to do this in remembrance of Him. We remember the work that He did for us. We remember that His body was broken for us, that His blood was shed for us. Tonight, as we participate in communion, we're going to do it a little different. We are going to ask you to come forward, and Conrad and I would have the privilege to serve you here. As always, if there's gluten-free, we have gluten-free right here for you if that's necessary. But I'm going to ask Conrad, brother, I keep calling you pastor, man, look at God. So I don't have the authority to do that, by the way, but just let you know. But I'm going to ask Conrad if he'll pray for the emblems, and then we have a song that during that song, as the Lord leads, we welcome you to come.
Oh, to see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of wood. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame
Is there anybody that wants to be served that has not been served? It's coming up there right now to you guys. Friends, this is what Christ did for us. And we do it in remembrance of him. In just a moment, after everybody gets served, we're going to partake together. They didn't teach us what to do in Bible college when this happens. We're just going to wait in reverence. There we go. Anybody else that hasn't been served that would like to be served tonight? Let us together take the bread as we celebrate the Lord's body. Now the cup. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, God. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for your love poured out. We thank you, God, for laying down your life upon a cross. Father, that you restored man to be able to be in relationship with you once again, God. Father, you were the bridge, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for forgiving us. Thank you, God, for restoring us. God, thank you for going with us, God. Lord, we give you all the praise and all the glory, God. Lord, we thank you for the cross tonight. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, Lord bless you. Before we turn you loose, we just want to remind you that this Sunday we have sunrise service. Begins at 7 o'clock. Some of you I know in the past have been out there, braved it at 6 and 6:30. Praise God, 7 o'clock. So we've been out there a few times. It's another nickname of the Frozen Chosen. I know, because it was super cold out there, let me tell you. But you know what? What a privilege we have to come together and celebrate sunrise service together. So I want to personally invite you and welcome you to come. And then just following right after that, we have an awesome breakfast, a time of fellowship together with one another. And then this Sunday at 10 o'clock, we have one service where we are going to be celebrating the Lord's raising from the dead, fulfilling every promise in Scripture. And we're going to celebrate that together. Pastor Rhodes will bring a special word for us. And then we will be there'll be a special choir presentation in the morning. Pastor's going to preach a word. And then we're closing it off with a baptism service. It is going to be a phenomenal day. Amen. Praise the Lord. So, friends, encourage you, welcome you to come out. For those of you that know, if you want a good parking, come early. I love it. I want to see people like parking on the hill or something. It'll be amazing. Look at God. So God bless you. Be blessed this evening. And we will see you guys back Sunday morning for sunrise service. God bless you. Have a great evening.